Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please go rate and review on whatever platform you are listening to that offers those options. And please share. Please tell other people about this. These things do help because I would like people to learn more about the dictionary and the words and the English language, because I can tell you from experience that it is making me a better person. I am learning, and it's great. Spoiler alert, I am going to screw up some of the words, the pronunciations, because they, in this episode specifically, because they change a lot. Even though they might be spelled similarly, it's confusing. Okay, the first word is boff, B-O-F-F. It is the first form, transitive verb from 1937. This one is sometimes vulgar, probably often vulgar, and it means to have sexual intercourse with. This is from the word boff. Well, it is the word boff, which means blow or punch. And yeah, that's it for that. Next is boff again. It is the second form, or boffo, B-O-F-F-O. It is a noun from 1946. One, a hearty laugh. Number two, a gag or line that produces a hearty laugh. By the way, we are at the top of page 139. Number three, something that is conspicuously successful. Synonym is hit, H-I-T. So this is perhaps from the words box office. Not sure how. Oh, I guess box and office, combining the that. Okay, next is boffin, B-O-F-F-I-N, noun from 1945. It is chiefly British. A scientific expert, especially one involved in technological research. Next is boffo, adjective from 1949. Extremely successful. Synonym is sensational. So that's similar to that one that we read before. The number three definition for boff. Next is boffola. I think that's how it's pronounced. B-O-F-F-O-L-A. Boffola. Noun from 1947, and it means boff. But is it the first form or the second form? I don't know. It is an irregular form of the word boff. Next is Bofors. Bofors gun. Yep, or Bofors, something like that. Capital B-O-F-O-R-S. Second word, gun. Noun from 1939. A double-barreled automatic anti-aircraft gun. So this is Bofors, which was a munition works in Sweden. Next is bog. I guess some people say bag, maybe. It is the first form noun from the 14th century. Wet, spongy ground, especially a poorly drained, usually acid area rich in accumulated plant material, frequently surrounding a body of open water and having a characteristic flora as of sedges, heaths, and sphagnum. I did not make up that word. So we got sedges, S-E-D-G-E-S, heaths, and sphagnum, S-P-H-A-G-N-U-M. I am so curious about what that word is. Boggy is an adjective. So this is from, wow, Middle English, Scottish, from Scottish Gaelic, and Irish. It's the prefix bog, as in bogloacher, which means bulrushes, from the word bog, which means marshy. It literally means soft, from Middle Irish, boc, B-O-C-C, probably akin to the Old English bugan, which means to bend, and there's more at the word bow or bow. This reminds me of the bog of eternal stench from Labyrinth. That was not my best Huggle impersonation because I don't want to get too loud. I have to be a little louder to do it. And also, I haven't practiced. Next, we have the second form of bog. It is a verb from 1599. Transitive is first. To cause to sink into or as if into a bog. Synonyms are impede and mire, M-I-R-E. usually used with down, bogged down. Now we've got intransitive, to become impeded or stuck, usually used again with the word down. Next is the third form of bog. It is a noun from circa 1789. It is British, and we have the number two definition for the word lavatory, or they probably say lavatory. So this is short for the word bog house, which is from the British argot word bog, which means to defecate. Ah, okay. Good to know. Next is bogart, B-O-G-A-R-T. It is a transitive verb from 1966. Number one, we have the number two definition for the word bully. And number two, to use or consume without sharing. I think this is so funny that this is in the dictionary. So this is probably from Humphrey Bogart, who died in 1957, was an American film actor. So from what I understand, Humphrey Bogart, he smoked a lot of cigarettes in his movies, and he would often just let it sit there, and he wouldn't even smoke it, and it would just sit and burn out. And so that's where Bogart came from. That's what I've heard. Next is, let's see if I pronounce this correctly, bog asphodel, or asphodel. Bog, second word, A-S-P-H-O-D-E-L, noun from 1857. Either of two bog herbs, of the lily family. There was a huge section in parentheses that I skipped, but now I can tell you what it says. The two scientific names are Narthecium ossifragum, which is of Europe, and Narthecium americanum of the U.S. All right, next is bogey. You could spell it B-O-G-E-Y or B-O-G-I-E or B-O-G-Y. This is, where is it? It's a noun from 1826. Number one has certain pronunciations. Number two has certain pronunciations. Number five has a pronunciation. So I'll try and be specific. So number one looks like it's pronounced boogie or bogey or boogie. The synonyms are specter and phantom. Number two, pronounced like bogey or boogie or bogey, something like that. It is a source of fear, perplexity, or harassment. Number three is pronounced bogey. 3A is chiefly British, an average golfer score used as a standard for a particular hole or course. Well, that's interesting because in America, don't we use the word par, P-A-R, as the average golfer score and the standard? But in Britain, they say bogey? If you're British, let me know. Well, if you're British and you golf. Now we have 3B, one stroke over par on a hole in golf. Yeah, that's the one that I was familiar with. Number four is pronounced bogey, a numerical standard of performance set up as a mark to be aimed at, especially in competition. I feel like I read that terribly. Let's try it again. A numerical standard of performance set up as a mark to be aimed at, especially in competition. Number five is also bogey, an unidentified aircraft, especially one not positively identified as friendly and so assumed to be hostile or hostile. Now we have the second form of bogey. Yes, it is pronounced bogey. It is a transitive verb from 1948, to shoot a hole in golf in one over par. Next is, see, this is another one where the pronunciation gets really wonky. I would call it boogeyman. It is spelled bogeyman, B-O-G-E-Y or B-O-G-Y, but you can also, I think, say, boogeyman, bogeyman, boogeyman, or boogerman. I'm pretty sure it's telling me people pronounce it boogerman, which I think is hilarious. This is a noun from 1891. A monstrous imaginary figure used in threatening children. Number two, a terrifying or dreaded person or thing. Synonym is bugbear. Now we have boggle, B-O-G-G-L-E. It is a verb from 1598. First is intransitive. One, to start with fright or amazement. Be overwhelmed, as in, the mind boggles at the research needed. My mind is a boggle. Number two, to hesitate because of doubt, fear, or scruples. Now we've got transitive. Number one, synonyms are mishandle and bungle, B-U-N-G-L-E. Number two, to overwhelm with wonder or bewilderment, as in, boggle the mind. I always hated playing that game Boggle because I am so bad with words. Boggle is also a noun. All right, I think we got one more for this episode. It is bogey, B-O-G-I-E, or B-O-G-E-Y, noun from 1835. One, a low, strongly built cart. 2A is chiefly British, a swiveling railway truck. 2B, the driving wheel assembly consisting of the rear four wheels of a six-wheel automotive truck. Number three, a small supporting or aligning wheel, as on the inside perimeter of a tank tread. So we had boff, boffin, boffo, boffola, boffer's gun, bog, bogart, bog, asphodel, bogey, boogeyman, or boogerman, boggle, and bogey. Ooh, there were some good ones. I am going to pick boogeyman as the word of the episode because I think it's hilarious that some people pronounce it boogerman. I wonder if that's regional. Anyway, that is it for this episode. Until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this episode of The Dictionary. It is my podcast, and I enjoy reading and learning new words and definitions. All right, the first word in this episode is bogle, B-O-G-L-E. It could also be spelled with two G's. This is a noun from circa 1505. It is a British dialect word. The synonyms are goblin and specter. Bogle. Also, an object of fear or loathing. And then I'm going to tag on in Las Vegas. The origin is unknown, so some random person probably said bogle. All right, next we have, I think it is pronounced bugamile. Something like that. Capital B-O-G-O-M-I-L, or you could tag an E onto the end. Bugamile. It is a noun from 1841. A member of a medieval Bulgarian sect holding that God has two sons, the rebellious Satan and the obedient Jesus. Interesting. Let's see, this is from Middle Greek, Bogomilos, which is from Bogomilos, which means Bogomil, which is a 10th century Bulgarian priest who was a founder of the sect. Okay, next we have bogus. Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. Adjective from 1825. Not genuine. Synonyms are counterfeit and sham. Bogusly is an adverb and bogusness is a noun. And I don't know why they don't have the more slang definition in here, which I think would basically just mean like cool or good or whatever. But this is an obsolete, I still don't know what argot means. Bogus, it means counterfeit money. Okay, next we have bohea, B-O-H-E-A, noun from 1692. It just means a black tea, bohea. It is, it's a Chinese word, fujian, it says in parentheses. I do not know how to pronounce that. It's the hills in China where it was grown. So it is capital B-U-I with some accents. Again, do not know how to pronounce that, but I'm going to assume it is similar to bohea. And that is the hills in China where it is grown. Next is Bohemia, noun from 1861, a community of Bohemians, and also the world of Bohemians. Next is Bohemian with a capital B, noun from 1555. 1A, a native or inhabitant of Bohemia. 1B, the group of Czech dialects used in Bohemia. Well, where is Bohemia exactly? I should look at a map and find it out. Number two is often not capitalized. So we have 2A and 2B. 2A, the synonyms are vagabond and wanderer, especially the synonym gypsy. 2B, a person, as a writer or an artist, living an unconventional life, usually in a colony with others. Sounds actually kind of fun. Bohemian is an adjective and is also often capitalized. Next is Bohemian Brethren. Both B's are capitalized. Noun from 1857. I can't see the word Bohemian without thinking of Bohemian Rhapsody, also Weird Al's Bohemian Polka. Let's see. This Bohemian Brethren is a Christian body originating in Bohemia in 1467 and forming a parent body of the Moravian Church, Moravian. Next is Bohemianism. That is a lot of syllables. Noun from 1858. The unconventional way of life of Bohemians, Bohemianism. Next is boho, B-O-H-O. Noun from, it doesn't give a year. But we have the 2B definition for the word bohemian, which we can assume is from about 1555. Boho is also an adjective. Next is Bohr effect. Second word is effect. The first word is capital B-O-H-R. I don't know why I said them in that order. Noun from 1939. The decrease in, this is going to be a fun, long definition. Okay. The decrease in the oxygen affinity of a respiratory pigment, as hemoglobin, in response to decreased blood pH resulting from increased carbon dioxide concentration in the blood. It wasn't terribly long, but it was longer than most definitions. This is from Christian Bohr, who was a Danish physiologist who died in 1911. Next is borium, B-O-H-R-I-U-M. It has the same prefix as the last one, Bohr effect, but it is from a different person with the last name Bohr. I'll just tell you now, it's from Niels Bohr, N-I-E-L-S. Doesn't say who it is, what he or she did, when they were born or died, etc. But this is a noun from 1994, a short-lived radioactive element produced artificially. And then it says to see the element table. We're getting closer and closer to the element table. I didn't realize that they found or created borium only in 1994, not that long ago. Let's see, next we have the Bohr theory. So it's the same B-O-H-R word. This one is also from Niels Bohr. Noun from 1923. A theory in early quantum physics, an atom consists of a positively charged nucleus about which revolves one or more electrons of quantized energy. Did you understand that? Great. Next is bohunk, B-O-H-U-N-K, noun from circa 1903. This is usually disparaging, so maybe don't use it. It is a person of Central European descent or birth. And the etymology says it is from the bow in Bohemian plus the word hunk, which is a person of Central European descent by shortening an alternating or an alternative of the word, Hungarian. So it has nothing to do with the typical word hunk that we think of, like a hunk of burning love. It's a shortened version of Hungarian. Interesting. Next is boil, B-O-I-L. First form verb from the 13th century. We are starting with intransitive, 1A. To come to the boiling point, 1B. To generate bubbles of vapor when heated, and that is used of a liquid. 1C, to cook in boiling water. They always say, that's not what they say. A watched pot never boils, something like that. And, you know, that's obviously not true. You could stare at a pot of water and it's going to boil eventually. But, you know, it's some weird stuff is going on in the brain because you feel like it's taking forever because you're focusing so much on watching that and waiting, and so time feels like it goes on forever. But if you distract yourself and go do other things, time is going to feel like it goes faster, and so it'll feel like it boiled faster. Number two, to become agitated. Synonym is seethe, S-E-E-T-H-E. Number three, to be moved, excited, or stirred up. 4A, to rush headlong. 4B, to burst forth. 5, to undergo the action of a boiling liquid. Now we have the transitive definitions. 1, to subject to the action of a boiling liquid. Number 2, to heat to the boiling point. 3, to form or separate as sugar or salt by boiling. Boilable is an adjective. Let's see. This is from Anglo-French bouillir. Boilir from the Latin bullire, which means to bubble, from bulla, which means bubble. Next is the second form of boil. It is a noun from the 15th century, a localized swelling and inflammation of the skin resulting from infection of a hair follicle and adjacent tissue having a hard central core and forming pus. I think I had a boil when I was a kid. I had this like weird little bubbly thing on my leg, and I asked my parents, what is this? And they said, oh, it's just a boil. It'll go away, or it's fine, whatever. And in my head, I thought that, you know, I'm a boy and I have a boil, so would a girl have a girl? It was a terrible, terrible joke that I thought of as a kid. This is from Middle English, an alternative of bile, B-I-L-E, from Old English, bile, B-Y-L, akin to the Old High German pula, which means bladder. Now we have the third form of boil. It is a noun from the 15th century. 1, the act or state of boiling. 2, a swirling upheaval, as of water. 3, a boiled dish of seafood, vegetables, and seasonings, as in a crab boil. Also, a gathering at which this dish is served. That is a bit of a tongue twister, at which this dish is served. All right, last for this episode is boil down, two words, verb from 1731. First is transitive. 1, to reduce in bulk by boiling. 2, synonyms are condense and summarize, as in boil down a report. Now we have intransitive. 1, to undergo reduction in bulk by boiling. 2A, to be equivalent in summary. Synonym is amount, as in his speech boiled down to a plea for more money. And then 2B, to reduce ultimately, as in your choices boiled down to 3. So the words were bogle, bogomil, bogus, bohi, bohemia, bohemian, bohemian brethren, bohemianism, boho, bore effect, boreum, bore theory, bohunk, boil, 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 boil down. I think I'm just going to pick bogus as the word of the episode because, you know, I was a kid of the 80s and bogus was a word that was said a lot. And, you know, I sort of like Bill and Ted, and they had a movie called Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. And at the time of recording, there is a movie, the third of the trilogy is coming out relatively soon. And while I don't have high expectations for it, I am definitely going to watch it eventually and probably enjoy it. So that is it. You know, I was a little distracted at the end of the last episode, and I don't remember if I picked a word. So I'm just scanning through to see if I did. And I think I did. I think I picked boogeyman. Okay, that's it. That's the end of this one. Thank you for listening. And this has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the Dictionary Podcast. Okay, let's say these things that are called words. The first of these so-called words is boiler, B-O-I-L-E-R. It is a noun from circa 1540. 1, one that boils. 2A, a vessel used for boiling. 2B, the part of a steam generator in which water is converted into steam and which consists usually of metal shells and tubes. 2C, a tank in which water is heated or hot water is stored. Next is boiler maker. It is two words, noun from 1865. 1, a worker who makes assembles or repairs boilers. I was actually going to make the joke. It's the person or the thing that makes the thing that I just read about, but I didn't actually expect it to be in here. And then number two, whiskey with a beer chaser. Beer chaser just means that you drink it afterwards. Next is boilerplate. One word, noun from 1897. One, syndicated material supplied especially to weekly newspapers in matrix or plate form. 2A, standardized text. 2B, formulaic or hackneyed language, as in bureaucratic boilerplate. Number three, tightly packed icy snow. Why is that called boilerplate? I don't think I'm familiar with that one. All right, next is boiler room. Two words, noun from 1903. One, a room in which a boiler is located. Number two, a room equipped with telephones used for making high pressure, usually fraudulent sales pitches. Yeah, they probably call it a boiler room because they're high pressure and it's high stress, and you know, boilers are also full of high pressure, you know, steam stuff. I'm thinking of the movie The Shining. They had to release the pressure in the boilers so they wouldn't explode. Next is boiler suit. One word. Suit is S-U-I-T. Noun from 1928. And we have the synonym coverall, which I assume would also just be overall. Interesting. Overall and coverall. They just took off the C. What happened there? All right. Next is boiling. First form adjective from the 14th century. 1A, heated to the boiling point. 1B, the synonym is torrid, T-O-R-R-I-D, as in a boiling sun. 2, intensely agitated, as in a boiling sea, also as in boiling with anger. Now we have the second form of boiling, adverb from 1607, to an extreme degree. Synonym is very, as in boiling mad or boiling hot. Next is boiling point. Two words, noun from 1773. One, the temperature at which a liquid boils. 2A, the point at which a person becomes uncontrollably angry. 2B, the point of crisis. And then we have the 17B definition for the word head, H-E-A-D. So head has at least 18 individual definitions or 17 main definitions. Wow. Okay. And then we have an example, matters that reached the boiling point. When I said 2A before, for some reason in my memory, I feel like I said 2B accidentally, but I have no idea. So maybe I said 2B. Or maybe I said 2A. I guess we'll find out later. Okay, next is boil over. Two words, verb from the 15th century. Looks like it's just intransitive. One, to overflow while boiling. Two, to become so incensed as to lose one's temper. And then boil over is a noun. Next is the word boink, B-O-I-N-K. It is a transitive verb. I'm surprised there's not more than one definition, but it is from 1987, sometimes vulgar, and it just means to copulate with. And then the etymology says boink or boing. Those are interjections of a reverberating sound. That's where they get the sound or the word from. I thought that there would be other definitions for boink as well, but I guess not. All right, next we have, this is a French couple of words that I'm going to totally screw up. I think it's pronounced Bodark, something like that. B-O-I-S, second word, D apostrophe A-R-C. This is a noun from 1805, and we have the synonym Osage orange. I think that would be it. Also, it's wood, so it's a type of wood, and this is American French, literally means bow wood or bow wood. I never know how to pronounce that word, because sometimes the context does not help me, Bowwood. That's probably, yeah, bow, like an arrow, a bow and arrow. That's what I think they're talking about. Bowwood. Okay. Next is boisserie. B-O-I-S-E-R-I-E. It is a noun from 1832. A panel or paneling of carved wood. This is French again from, I'm assuming bois, B-O-I-S, which means wood, from Old French of Germanic origin, akin to the Old High German busk, B-U-S-K, which means forest. Now, why the previous word is, it says beau dark or something like that, but why wouldn't it be bois dark? I don't know. French is weird. All right, next is boisterous. It is an adjective from the 14th century. One is obsolete, and then we have 1A, 1B, and 1C. So 1A, synonym is coarse. 1B, synonyms are durable and strong. 1C, synonym is massive. 2A, noisily turbulent. Synonym is rowdy. 2B, marked by or expressive of exuberance and high spirits. 3. Synonyms are stormy and tumultuous. And then another synonym at the end is vociferous. Boisterously is an adverb and boisterousness is a noun. And this is from Middle English, boistous, which means crude or clumsy. Next we have boite, B-O-I-T-E, and then there is the caret accent over the I. This is a noun from 1922, and we have the synonym nightclub, boite, and it's French, literally means box. I think a nightclub is a little bit more than just a box, but I'm sure there was some reason they chose that. Next is bok choy, B-O-K, second word C-H-O-Y or C-H-O-I. Oh, it could also be pak choy, P-A-K. This is a noun from 1847, a Chinese cabbage forming an open head with long white stalks and green leaves. The scientific name is Brassica rapa chinensis. So this is Chinese word, it says Guangdong, which I assume might be like the region in China that it's from. Bok choy literally means white vegetable. That's what that means. Next is Bokhara, capital B-O-K-H-A-R-A. It is a noun from 1900, an oriental rug characterized by fine knotting, that's K-N-O-T, knotting, and a design of usually three rows of octagonal medallions. Maybe I can find an example of a Bokhara. Let's see, this is from Uzbekistan. It's about all the information I get. Next is, I think it's pronounced Bukmal or Bokmal, capital B-O-K-M-A-L, and then the A has the little circle over it. This is a noun from 1931, a literary form of Norwegian developed by the gradual reform of written Danish, and then compare to the word that I do not know how to say, which I'm going to try to say as Nynorsk, N-Y-N-O-R-S-K, Nynorsk. This is, Bokmål, is a Norwegian word that literally means book language. Interesting. Okay, next and last word for this episode is Bola, B-O-L-A, or B-O-L-A-S, which would also be the plural, singular and plural, I guess. Noun from 1818, a cord with weights attached to the ends for throwing at and entangling an animal. This is an American Spanish bolas from Spanish bola, which means ball. Let's see, we had a boiler, boilermaker, boilerplate, boiler room, boiler suit, boiling point, boil over, boink, bodark, boisserie, boisterous, boit, bok choy, bokhara, bokmal, and bola. I am going to pick bokmal as the word of the episode because, I don't know, it was just kind of interesting. Book language. I mean, this That's, I don't know, it's probably related to the dictionary in some way. All right, that is it for the words. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. All right, we are at the last quarter of page 139. The first word is bold. B-O-L-D. First form, adjective from before the 12th century. 1A. Fearless before danger. Synonym is intrepid. 1B. Showing or requiring a fearless, daring spirit. 2. Synonyms are impudent and presumptuous. 3 is obsolete. Synonyms are assured or assured and confident. 4. Synonyms are sheer and steep. But you don't want to combine them because then you'll say sheep or steer, as in bold cliffs. 5. Synonyms are adventurous and free, as in a bold thinker. 6. Standing out prominently. 7. Being or set in bold face. Boldly is an adverb, and boldness is a noun. And this one's especially funny because all of the words in the book are in bold, and then the definitions are in not bold. But like 1A and 4 and 7, those are also bold. And then the extra forms, the adverbs and nouns at the end, are also in bold. So bold is bolded in a boldly fashion. Okay, this is from Middle English, from Old English, biald, which is akin to the Old High German bald, B-O-L, or B-A-L-D, which means bold. Second form of bold, noun from circa 1871. Synonym is boldface, which is our next word, noun from circa 1889, a heavy-faced type. Also, printing in boldface. Boldfaced is next. There's a D at the end of that, and there is a hyphen between the two words. Adjective from 1591. 1. Bold in manner or conduct. Synonym is impudent. Number 2. Which would be usually, bold-faced with no hyphen, being or set in boldface. Next is bowl, B-O-L-E. It is not B-O-W-L. That will come later. Noun from the 14th century, and we have the synonym. It's the 1A definition for the word trunk. So you are not going to get to learn what bowl is for many years from now. Next is bolero, B-O-L-E-R-O, noun from 1787. 1. A Spanish dance characterized by sharp turns, stamping of the feet, and sudden pauses in a position with one arm arched over the head. Also, music in 3/4 time for a bolero. 2. A loose waist-length jacket open at the front. Maybe that jacket is what they wear while they are dancing the bolero with bolero music playing. This is a Spanish word, if you couldn't figure it out. I feel like in one of those Legend of Zelda games, was there a bolero song in there? I think that was the last of the Zelda games that I played. Anyway, moving on to bolete, B-O-L-E-T-E, noun from 1914, any of a family of fleshy, stalked, poor fungi that usually grow on the ground in wooded areas, especially the synonym boletus, or it is boletus, B-O-L-E-T-U-S. I know that because that is the next word, but the family name is boletaceae. So here we go with boletus. It is a noun from 1601. The plural, by the way, is boletus or boletae or boletae. Any of a genus of boletes, as a porcini, some of which are poisonous and others edible. And then the genus name is boletus again. So this is from the Latin word, which means mushroom, or it is the Latin word that means mushrooms, boletas. Next is bolide, B-O-L-I-D-E, noun from 1834. A large meteor. Synonym is fireball, especially one that explodes. There's a lot of words for meteor, meteorite, shooting star, etc. But I haven't heard of this one, a bolide. Let's see, this is from the Greek boli, which means to throw or stroke. So that's interesting. Okay, next is Bolivar, noun from circa 1895. It just says, see the money table. So it's a kind of money. This is American Spanish, Bolivar, from Simon Bolivar. So they took his last name and turned it into money somewhere. Next is Boliviano, noun from circa 1872. I said it in a sort of Italian accent, but it's actually American Spanish from Boliviano, which is an adjective which means Bolivian. And then again, it just says, see the money table. So this must be the money in Bolivia. Next is Bol, B-O-L-L. We also had B-O-L-E, but these are spelled differently. They pronounce the same. Noun from the 15th century. The pod or capsule of a plant, as cotton. Next is Bollard, B-O-L-L-A-R-D. This is a noun from circa 1775. One, a post of metal or wood on a wharf around which to fasten mooring lines. Two, we have the number one definition for the word bit, B-I-T-T. Three is chiefly British. Any of a series of short posts set at intervals to delimit an area as a traffic island or to exclude vehicles. Next is bollocks, B-O-L-L-I-X. Verb, a transitive verb from 1937, to throw into disorder. Also the synonym bungle, usually used with the word up, bollocks up. So this is an oh, and then bollocks is also a noun. This is an alternative of bollocks, B-O-L-L-O-C-K-S, which is our next word. Noun from 1774. One is chiefly British and usually vulgar. We have the synonym testicles. And then number two, also chiefly British, usually vulgar, the synonym nonsense. This is alternative of ballocks, B-A-L-L-O-C-K-S. I don't remember what that means, which is the plural of ballock, which means testis, from Middle English, from Old English, bialuk, which means, and there's more at the word ball. Next is boll weevil. Two words, B-O-L-L, W-E-E-V-I-L, noun from 1895, a usually grayish or brown weevil that feeds on the squares and bolls of the cotton plant. That's why they call it a boll weevil. The scientific name is Anthonomus grandis grandis. Next is bollworm. It's that same B-O-L-L word. This is one word, though, noun from 1847. And then we have the synonym corn earworm. Fun. Also, any of several other moths that feed on cotton bolls as larvae. So the bollworm eats the bolls, which eat the cotton bolls. No, I don't know. Moving on to Bollywood with a capital B. Noun from 1976, the motion picture industry in India. And this is taking the B from Bombay, and then in parentheses it says Mumbai, because those are the same city. They changed the name. I think Bombay was the first name, and then they changed it to Mumbai. And that is the traditional center of the Indian film industry, and then they took the rest of the word from Hollywood, if you didn't know. And it's a huge, booming movie industry over there. They probably make more movies than Hollywood does, or at least America. Lots and lots of movies come out of there. Super popular. Next is bolo, B-O-L-O, noun from circa 1900. A long, heavy, single-edged knife of Philippine origin used to cut vegetation and as a weapon. All right, next and last word for this episode is, there's so many ways to spell this or pronounce this. It is bologna, B-O-L-O-G-N-A, could also be spelled B-A-L-O-N-E-Y, and bologna, bologna, I think some people like to say Bologna or something along those lines. This is a noun from 1596, and this will go on to the next page a little bit. A large smoked sausage of beef, veal, and pork. Also, a sausage made as of turkey. I have to move my paperclip out of the way. As of turkey to resemble bologna. I feel like literally just last night or the night before, I had a dream that it was involving bologna, and I do not know why. That is so weird. I am going to have to put a clip of Weird Al's song in here, My Bologna, because not only is it a good song, but it's the song that really made him, like, made him get his start. It's what got him, his fame exploded. Why am I describing this so terribly? He recorded it in a bathroom, I think, maybe by himself, maybe with somebody else when he was still in college. And he sent it to Dr. Demento, and that was it. He was famous after that. Ooh, a little hungry one, hungry one. Open up a package of my bologna. By the way, this is short for bologna sausage from Bologna, Italy. They probably hate the way we pronounce it, right? So those are all the words. Thank you very much for listening. I have to pick one, though. There were a couple that I liked. Where were they? Well, I'm going to pick bold as the word of the episode because, you know, you got to put words in bold sometimes, and it's in bold here in the book, so that's cool. That's it. Thank you for listening. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Feel free to share this with other weirdos and subscribe if that is possible on your preferred podcast platform, and rate and review, especially if you're on Apple. That really helps. So the first word is bolognese, capital B-O-L-O-G-N-E-S-E. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I think 6 or 7 different ways to pronounce this word. Let's see. Bolognese, 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 bolognese. Those are similar. Oh, bolognese, 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 or bolognese. Oh, boy. Adjective from 1754. One, of relating to or characteristic of Bologna, Italy. Number 2, being or prepared with tomato sauce flavored with meat. Next we have bolometer, B-O-L-O, meter, noun from 1881, a very sensitive thermometer whose electrical resistance varies with temperature and which is used in the detection and measurement of feeble thermal radiation. Yeah, feeble thermal radiation, and is especially adapted to the study of infrared spectra. Bolometric is an adjective, and bolometrically is an adverb. And let's see, this is from Greek boli, which means stroke or beam of light, from baleen, which means to throw, plus the E and the O and the meter, and there's more at the word devil. Okay? Next is bologna, B-O-L-O-N-E-Y. It is a variation of the second form of baloney with an A, which I assume then the synonym would take you back to baloney or Bologna, which was at the end of the last episode. Next is bolo tie. Two words, could also be bola tie with an A, bola tie. Noun from 1964. A cord fastened around the neck with an ornamental clasp and worn as a necktie, called also bolo. But why didn't they mention this when I read bolo? Okay. Next is Bolshevik, capital B-O-L-S-H-E-V-I-C, or no, K. Don't know why I said C. Brain fart. Noun from 1917. One, a member of the extremist wing of the Russian Social Democratic Party that seized power in Russia by the revolution of November 1917. I should know more about this, but I don't. Number two, we have the number three definition for the word communist. Bolshevik is also an adjective. Let's see, this is Russian Bolshevik from Bolshiai, something like that, which means greater. So they thought they were greater than everybody else? I don't know. I'm just guessing. Maybe we can get a little bit more information because the next word is Bolshevism. This is a noun from 1917. One, the doctrine or program of the Bolsheviks advocating violent overthrow of capitalism. And then number two, Russian communism. So yes, that helps to me. Thank you. Next we have Bolshevist with a capital B, noun or adjective from 1917. And then we just have the synonym Bolshevik. So they can be Bolshevik or Bolshevist. Next is Bolshevize, V-I-Z-E at the end. Transitive word, transitive verb. Wow, I don't even need the words in front of me to screw it up. I just break it up, I flippy-floppy in my head. This is a transitive verb from 1919, to make Bolshevist. Bolshevization is a noun. So it's the act of converting somebody to a Bolshevist. Next is Bolshi, or Balshi, B-O-L-S-H-I-E, or S-H-Y. Noun or adjective from 1918. One is often capitalized when we have the synonym Bolshevik, so they just shortened it to Bolshi. Number two is British, refusing to obey or help, defiant and uncooperative. Next is bolster. First form noun from before the 12th century. One, a long pillow or cushion. Number two, a structural part designed to eliminate friction or provide support or bearing. This is from, let's see, Old English, belg, B-E-L-G, which means bag. And there's more at the word belly. Second form of bolster. It is a transitive verb from the 15th century. One, to support with or as if with a bolster. Synonym is reinforce. Two, to give a boost to. Synonym, or no, as in, news that bolstered his spirits. I need to slow my brain down. Bolsterer is a noun. And here we go with the last word of the episode. It is bolt, B-O-L-T. First form, we got a bunch of definitions, and we have a picture of some bolts. So this is a noun from before the 12th century. 1A, a shaft or missile designed to be shot from a crossbow or catapult, especially a short, stout, usually blunt-headed arrow. 1B, a lightning stroke, also the synonym thunderbolt. 2A, a wood or metal bar or rod used to fasten a door. 2B, if you're in a hotel, you should always bolt it. You never know if somebody's going to try and get in. 2B, the part of a lock that is shot or withdrawn by the key. 3, a roll or cloth or wallpaper or of specified length. The ors and the ofs look very similar from this distance. Maybe I should get closer. Number 4, a metal rod or pin for fastening objects together that usually has a head at one end and a screw thread at the other and is secured by a nut. So here I will describe the seven bolts. The first one, this is going to be fun. Let's see, the first one just looks like a standard bolt screw with a flathead, you'd use a flathead screwdriver in this one. I only know that because it shows the indentation. And then there is a nut at the other end, and then it has, so there's a little hole at the end opposite from the head where you can put in a little wire to like keep it in place. Let's see. And then the head is curved. It's like a part of a, it's like an arc of a circle. The next one, oh, and then the threads go all the way down, because the next one, only about a third of it has threads, and then the rest of it is smooth, and there's a nut in the threads. The next one is very similar. It's only about a third of it that has threads. There's a nut in that part. The rest of it is smooth, and it looks like the head is relatively flat. The next one doesn't... You don't use a screwdriver on this one because it's just got a like a hook part at the end, and you can turn it with your fingers, usually probably pretty easily, and then the rest of it has threads, and there's a nut on it. The next one is a U-shaped, so there are threads on the ends of both of the U's, just a little bit, and there's nuts on both of those. The next one, I don't think I've ever seen this. What is this? I wonder if this is what they use to, like, hang stuff. So the head of this screw, the bolt, is pretty flat. There's a little bit that's smooth of the body of it, and then most of it, maybe two-thirds, has threads. But then there's these, like, weird pieces that are coming off from, like, the top of the threads, and then they flare out towards the bottom, and I don't know what that is. And then the last one looks like a pretty short bolt. The top of it sort of angles out to where you would put the screwdriver in, and then the body of it is all threads with a nut on it, but it's very short, much shorter than the rest of them. All right, moving on to the rest of the bolt definitions. 5A, a block of timber to be sawed or cut. 5B, a short round section of a log. 6, a metal cylinder that drives the cartridge into the chamber of a firearm, locks the breech, and usually contains the firing pin and extractor. So we had bolognese, bolometer, bologna, bolotie, Bolshevik, Bolshevism, Bolshevist, Bolshevize, Bolshe, Bolster, and Bolt. I am going to pick bolometer. Oh, I got the burps. As the word of the episode. Because, you know, it's always good to learn about new sciencey stuff. Speaking of, I've been listening to more of that Ologies podcast, which is great. I have a ton of episodes to catch up on, and it is super fascinating and funny. So, if you haven't heard of it, you should go check it out. That is it for this episode. Thank you for listening. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information, and we'll be again tomorrow. Thank you and goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. I forgot to mention, we are on page 140. Here we go. First word is bolt again, B-O-L-T. First form was in the last episode. We have the 2, 3, 4, and 5. Well, that's not how you say that. The second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth forms in this episode. So the second form, verb from the 13th century, starting with intransitive. 1, to move suddenly or nervously. Synonym is start. 2, to move or proceed rapidly. Synonym is dash. 3A, to dart off or away. Synonym is flee. 3B, to break away from control or a set course. 4, to break away from or oppose one's previous affiliation, as with a political party or sports team. 5, to produce seed prematurely. Now we have the transitive definitions. 1A is archaic. Synonyms are shoot and discharge. 1B, synonyms are flush and start, as in bolt rabbits. Okay, number 2, to say impulsively. Synonym is blurt. 3, to secure with a bolt, as in bolt the door. 4, to attach or fasten with bolts. 5, to eat hastily or without chewing, as in, bolted his breakfast. 6, to break away from or refuse to support, as a political party. Moving on to the third form of bolt, it is an adverb from the 14th century. 1, in an erect or straight-backed position. Synonym is rigidly, as in, sat bolt upright. Number 2 is archaic. Synonyms are directly and straight. Fourth form of bolt, noun from 1550, the act or an instance of bolting. Fifth form of bolt, transitive verb from the 13th century. One, to sift as flour, usually through fine meshed cloth. They call that bolt? Okay. Number two is archaic, and we have the number two definition for the word sift. This is from Middle English, bulten, from Anglo-French, bulleter, of Germanic origin, akin to Middle High German, butlin, or butiln, which means to sift, from butel, which means bag, from Old High German, butil. Next is bolt action, two words with a hyphen, adjective from 1896. This is of a firearm, loaded by means of a manually operated bolt. I don't know anything about guns, or just very little, so I don't know what the bolt is. Next is bolter, noun from circa 1699, one that bolts, as a horse given to running away, b, a voter who bolts from a political party. Next is a phrase, bolt from the blue, 1907. It means a complete surprise, something totally unexpected, called also bolt out of the blue. You could also say comes out of the blue. You don't always use the word bolt. Next is, you got to say this one very carefully, bolt hole, B-O-L-T hyphen H-O-L-E, noun from circa 1851, chiefly British. A place of escape or refuge. Bolt hole. Next is bolt rope. It's like a bolt and a rope. Noun from the 14th century. A strong rope stitched to the edges of a sail to strengthen it. Next is bolus. B-O-L-U-S. Noun from 1562. One, a rounded mass, as 1A, a large pill. 1B, a soft mass of chewed food. Number 2A, a dose of a substance, as a drug, given intravenously. 2B, a large dose of a substance given by injection for the purpose of rapidly achieving the needed therapeutic concentration in the bloodstream. This is from the Greek word bolos, which means lump. I wonder why. I wonder if when they give it to you, there is a bit of a lump under your skin, and that's where that comes from. Next is the word bomb, B-O-M-B, first form noun from 1684. 1A, an explosive device fused to detonate under specified conditions. What sort of bombs were they making in 1684? 1B, synonym is atomic bomb. Also, nuclear weapons in general, usually used with the word the. 2. A vessel for compressed gases, as 2A, a pressure vessel for conducting chemical experiments. 2B, a container for an aerosol, as an insecticide. Synonyms are, oh no, one synonym, spray can. 3. A rounded mass of lava exploded from a volcano. 4. A lead-lined container for radioactive material. 5. Synonyms are failure and flop, as in, the play was a bomb. Yeah, that's bad. Next is number 6. It is British, and it means a large sum of money. 7A is also British. A great success. Synonym is hit. So if you're in America and you say it was a bomb, that's bad. But if you're in England somewhere and you say bomb, it's great. Now we have 7B is slang, one that is striking or extraordinary, used with the word the, as in, their new album is the bomb. That is a pretty new way that we use that word. Also, did they start saying it in Britain before we said it in America? Interesting. 8A, a long pass in football. 8B, a very long shot, as in basketball, as in shooting three-point bombs. Also, the synonym home run. So we had football and basketball and baseball. Nine, something unexpected and unpleasant, often used with the word drop, as in dropped a bomb with her resignation. This is from French, bomba, which is from the Italian, bomba, which probably from the Latin bombus, which means deep hollow sound, from the Greek bombos, of emet origin. I actually put a marker on here, and I know that I've looked this up before, and I cannot remember. Imitative. I'm still not exactly sure what that means in this context. It's of imitative origin. Okay. Second form of bomb. It is a verb from 1688. Transitive is first. One, to attack with or as if with bombs. Synonym is bombard. Number two, to defeat decisively. Three, to hit as a baseball or a golf shot very hard. So to hit very hard. Intransitive, number one, to fall flat. Synonym is fail. Number two is slang, to move rapidly, as in bombed down the hill. Bombing is a noun. Next is bombard, B-O-M-B-A-R-D. This is the last word, but we do have two forms. So the first form is a noun from the 15th century, a late medieval cannon used to hurl large stones. And then the second form of bombard is a transitive verb from 1686. One, to attack, especially with artillery or bombers. We are now at the top of the second column. Number two, to assail vigorously or persistently, as with questions. And number three, to subject to the impact of rapidly moving particles, as electrons. The synonym is the word attack. Bombardment is a noun. And that is it for that. So we had bolt, bolt action, bolter, bolt from the blue, bolt hole, bolt rope, bolus, bomb, and bombard. I am going to pick bolus as the word of the episode because it's my podcast and I do what I want. That is it. Thank you for listening. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this episode of the podcast. It is called, the podcast is called The Dictionary. This is, let's see, what is today? Today is August 13th. I am recording this on August 2nd. Just a couple days ago, I got a channel on this Discord server thing for podcast. It's called Cast Junkie. And so I, you know, because I had been there for a little while and I had, you know, I had passed all the rules. They allowed me to get a channel for, well, it's what I'm unofficially calling the Parks Network, which is this podcast plus my wife's podcast plus my other podcast. And so it's a dedicated place where I can message stuff there. And if people want to talk to me, they can talk to me there. So Cast Junkie is the Discord server. If you are on there or you want to be on there, that is another place that we can chat now and again. In addition to the email and Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Google Voice, all those fun stuff, and Patreon, if you decide to be a patron of the Patreon. Okay, the first word is bombardier, B-O-M-B-A-R-D-I-E-R. Could also say bombarder, something. Okay, noun from 1560, number 1A is archaic, and we have the synonym artilleryman, or is it artilleryman? 1B, a non-commissioned officer in the British artillery. Number 2, a bomber crew member who releases the bombs. Next is bombardone or bombarden. Yeah, it is with a D-O-N at the end. It is a noun from 1856. 1, a bass tuba. I did not know. First of all, I did not know that there was a bass tuba. I mean, I've heard of, there are larger tubas, but I don't think I've officially heard of bass tuba, which is awesome, and I have to go look that up and post a picture. I also didn't know that it was called a bombardone. Bombardone, yeah. Okay, number two, the bass member of the Shawm family. Shawm, S-H-A-W-M. What is the Shawm family? Do I need to go do some research? Yeah, probably. Interesting. By the way, Shawm and family are not capitalized, so it's not like a proper name of the family with the last name Shawm. So what is this? It is French from the Italian Bombardone. Next is Bombast, noun from lost my place, 1583. Pretentious, inflated speech or writing. I do not speak or write in a bombastic way. This is from Middle English, bombast, which means cotton padding. And that is from Middle French, bombasse, which is from Middle Latin, bombac or bombax, which means cotton, C-O-T-T-O-N. So interesting, which is an alternative of Latin bombyx or bombyx, which means silkworm or silk, from the Greek bombyx or bombyx. But how that became pretentious, inflated speech or writing is so fascinating. All right, moving on to bombastic. It is an adjective from 1704. Oh, this reminds me, this is not for kids, but it reminds me of a Flight of the Conchords song. I don't remember the actual name. I think it might just be called Boom, but I think they say bombastic in there somewhere. All right, this is an adjective from 1704, marked by or given to bombast. Synonyms are pompous and overblown. Bombastically is an adverb. Next is bombazine, noun from 1572. One, a twilled fabric with silk warp and worsted filling. I feel like I've come across this word before, but it goes on two lines, so it's extra confusing. Worsted filling. Number two, a silk fabric in twill weave dyed black. This is, let's see, from Middle Latin, bombacinum or bambicinum, which is a silken texture, which is from the Latin, the neutral of bombicinus, which means of silk. And that's good for that. Next is bomb, B-O-M-B-E. There's an E at the end. This is a noun from 1892. A frozen dessert, ooh, usually containing ice cream and formed in layers in a mold. Yeah, I think I've heard of these, but I honestly don't think I've ever eaten one. It is French, which literally means bomb, so it must sort of look like a round bomb or something. Let's probably have to post a picture of one of those. Next is Bombay, B-O-M-B-E. There's an accent over the E, or you could take the accent out. And it looks like it could also be pronounced bon or bom, something like that. Again, this is French. Adjective from 1904, having outward curving lines, and it is usually used of furniture. Bomb or Bombay. Next is bombed. So bomb with an ED, adjective from 1956, affected by alcohol or drugs. Synonyms are drunk and high. I am not bombed while recording this podcast. Next is bombed out, two words with a hyphen, adjective from 1972. One, destroyed by bombing, as in a bombed out factory. Number two, extremely dilapidated or run down, as in a bombed out inner city neighborhood. You watch old movies or you see documentary footage of cities that have been destroyed after, say, World War I or World War II or any time, and the buildings are just bombed out and completely destroyed, and it's really heartbreaking to see that stuff, and they have to rebuild it all. I mean, there were kids growing up, for some reason I'm thinking of in London, in Britain, during World War II, they had to live with bombs, you know, other countries too, but they had to live with bombs hitting their cities, maybe daily or weekly or whatever it was, and this was just normal for them. Terrible, terrible situation. Next we have bomber, noun from 1862. One that bombs, especially an airplane designed for bombing. Two, Synonym is bomber jacket. 3, a skilled long-distance shooter in basketball. Next is bomber jacket, 2 words, noun from 1952. A zippered, usually leather jacket with front pockets and knitted cuffs and waistband. Next is bombinate. It is a verb, looks like it's just intransitive, from 1880. Synonyms are buzz and drone. Bombination is a noun. Could you give us an example of how you would use this exactly? No? Okay. Bombinate. Next is bomblet. It's a bomb made of eggs? No. Noun from 1937. A small bomb, especially one of the many small bombs that make up a cluster bomb. Next is bomb-proof. 1 word, adjective from 1702. 1. Safe from the force of bombs. 2. Extremely sturdy or durable. Yeah, something would have to be ridiculously extremely sturdy or durable to be considered bomb-proof. As in, what's this is an interesting example, a bomb-proof parka? Like the thing that you wear outside, a parka that's bomb-proof? Yeah. Also as in, a bomb-proof horse. Whose horse is bomb-proof? What living creature is bomb-proof other than maybe a cockroach? Next is bombshell. 1 word, noun from 1708. 1. We have the 1A definition for the word bomb. Number 2. 1 that is stunning, amazing, or devastating, as in, the book was a political bombshell. Next is bomb sight. Like you see with your eyes, and that is sight. It is 1 word, noun from 1917. A sighting device for aiming bombs. Next is, all right, so there's a bunch of definition or ways to pronounce this, and I shall go through them. It is the word, let's see, the first pronunciation is bona fide, B-O-N-A, second word, F-I-D-E, bona fide, could also be pronounced bona fide, or bona fide, or bona fide, or fida, something like that. And the one that I hear people say that is not in here is bona fide. They didn't put that one here. But anyway, lots of ways you can say it. So it's good. You're good. You say it one way and you're fine. This is an adjective from 1632. 1, made in good faith without fraud or deceit, as in a bona fide offer to buy a farm. Number 2, made with earnest intent. Synonym is sincere. 3, neither specious nor counterfeit. Specious? Did I say that word right? S-P-E-C-I-O-U-S. Specious or specious. And then a synonym for that is genuine or genuine. And then another synonym for everything is authentic. Let's see, this is Latin, which literally means in good faith. All right, next and last word is, again, a couple ways to say this, bona fides or bona fides. It is two words. We just added an S to the fide word. This is a noun from 1665. 1, good faith. Synonym is sincerity. Number 2, the fact of being genuine, which is often plural. Number 3, evidence of one's good faith or genuineness, also often plural. And number 4, evidence of one's qualifications or achievements, also often plural. And then this again is Latin, literally means good faith. The previous one was in good faith. This one just says good faith. So we had bombardier, bombardin, bombast, bombastic, bombazine, bomb, bombay, bombed, bombed out, bomber, bomber jacket, bombinate, bomblet, bombproof, bombshell, bombsite, bona fide, bona fides. That sounds weird. Where was that one? I'm going to pick, I think, well, I do kind of want to pick bomb because that's the dessert, but I think I will pick bombast as the word of the episode because the connection of its etymology and its actual definition, which was pretentious, inflated speech or writing, I thought was super interesting and weird. So, while I'm thinking of it, I probably should have brought this up before. I got a new review, I think, which was very kind of whoever wrote this. Thank you very much. So I don't think I read this one before, but it is a 5-star review. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And it just says educational and meditative. Yeah, maybe still someday I'll do one that's even more meditative. And the person who wrote that, their name is just the alphabet. And maybe I should double check that they didn't change anything weird. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, and Z. Doesn't say and, just says Y, Z. So thank you to that person who's called the alphabet, I'm going to say, or Abkadefka Jekyllmanofrit Skuverses. And yeah, if you want to leave a review, that would be awesome. It would help me get some more exposure on this because, you know, that's how this stuff works. And please share it and let everybody you know that there is a podcast called The Dictionary. This has been Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to The Dictionary. How are you doing today? I hope you are doing well. It is about the middle of August. The first word is bonanza. B-O-N-A-N-Z-A. It is a noun from 1829, and I think it was also the name of a show that was from decades ago that I don't think I ever watched because I was too young. And, yeah, I think that's what that is. Number one, an exceptionally large and rich mineral deposit, as of an ore, precious metal, or petroleum. 2A, something that is very valuable, profitable, or rewarding, as in a box office bonanza. 2B, a very large amount, as in a bonanza of sympathy. 2C, synonym is extravaganza, as in channels planning all day viewing bonanzas. What was that English? Channels planning all day viewing bonanzas. Okay, that is a quote from William Borders. This is Spanish, literally means calm sea. From Middle Latin bonacia or bonacia, it is an alternative of the Latin malacia from the Greek malakia, which literally means softness, and that is from malakos, which means soft. Okay, interesting. Next is Bonapartism, capital B-O-N-A-P-A-R-T-I-S-M. One word, noun from 1815. One, support of the French emperors Napoleon I, Napoleon III, or their dynasty. Number two, a political movement associated chiefly with authoritarian rule, usually by a military leader ostensibly supported by a popular mandate. Bonapartist is a noun or an adjective. Next is bonbon. You know how to spell it. Noun from 1770. One, a candy with chocolate or fondant coating and fondant center that sometimes contains fruits or nuts. Number two, something that is pleasing in a light or frivolous way, as in singing pop bonbons. I don't know why bonbon became the stereotypical phrase or, you know, or thing of being lazy and sitting around and eating bonbons all day. I'm not sure how that happened. I think that was interesting. But for some reason, maybe because, yeah, it's French, you feel a little fancy when you're eating a bonbon or imagining that you're eating a bonbon. You're lazy, but you're also kind of fancy at the same time. I don't know if I've ever eaten a bonbon. This is French, which is of the from the word bon, B-O-N, which means good. So good, good. From the Latin bonus, might say it a little bit differently than that, bonus. And there's more at the word bounty. Next is bond, B-O-N-D. First form, noun from the 12th century. I don't have a James Bond joke. Number one, something that binds or restrains. Synonym is fetter. By the way, there are a bunch of definitions for this. Number two, a binding agreement. Synonym is covenant. 3A, a band or cord used to tie something. 3B, a material or device for binding. 3C, an attractive force that holds together the atoms, ions, or groups of atoms in a molecule or crystal. 3D, an adhesive cementing material or fusible ingredient that combines, unites, or strengthens. Number 4, a uniting or binding element or force. Synonym is tie, T-I-E, as in the bonds of friendship. 5A, an obligation made binding by a money forfeit, also the amount of the money guarantee. Where are we? 5B, one who acts as bail or surety. Is that word? S-U-R-E-T-Y. Bail or surety, something. 5C, an interest-bearing certificate or public or private indebtedness. 5D, an insurance agreement pledging surety for financial loss caused to another by the act or default of a third person or by some contingency over which the third person may have no control. I hear about stocks and bonds, and they have to do with something financial, and I've never understood what they are, and that definition did not help in any way whatsoever. Number 6, the systematic lapping of brick in a wall. 7, the state of goods made, stored, or transported under the care of bonded agencies until the duties or taxes on them are paid. 8, a 100-proof straight whiskey aged at least 4 years under government supervision before being bottled. I just imagine the president just standing over it, watching it. He's supervising. And that is called also bonded whiskey. And then number 9, we have the synonym bond paper. This is from Middle English, band or bond, and there's more at the word band. Now we have the second form of bond. It is a verb from 1677, starting with transitive. 1, to lap, that's L-A-P, as brick, for solidity, that's what I was trying to say, for solidity of construction. 2A, to secure payment of duties and taxes on goods by giving a bond. 2B, to convert into a debt secured by bonds. 2C, to provide a bond for or cause to provide such a bond, as in bond an employee. 3A, to cause to adhere firmly. 3B, to embed in a matrix. 3C, to hold together in a molecule or crystal by chemical bonds. Now we have the intransitive definitions. 1, to hold together or solidify by or as if by means of a bond or binder. 2, to form a close relationship, especially through frequent association, as in the new mother bonded with her child. Bondable is an adjective. Bonder is a noun. Now we have the third form of bond. It is an adjective from the 14th century. It is archaic and it means bound in slavery. This one is from Middle English, bond with an E, which is a customary tenant, from Old English, bonda, which is a householder. Okay, next is bondage. I think this is related to the last one that we just read. This is a noun from the 14th century. 1, the tenure or service of a villein? What is this word? Well, the other ones are serf or slave, so it must be similar to a serf or a slave. That is serf, S-E-R-F. Villein, it looks like the word villain, but it's E-I-N at the end instead of A-I-N. So a villein, I'm just going to say it that way, a serf or a slave. Number 2, a state of being bound usually by compulsion, as of law or mastery, as 2A. Synonyms are captivity and serfdom. 2B, servitude or subjugation to a controlling person or force, as in young people in bondage to drugs. 3, sadomasochistic sexual practices involving the physical restraint of one partner. Yep, that's a thing that adults do. So if you are a child listening to this, ask an adult what it is, and then, I don't know. Again, have an adult conversation. Kids are smart, and please don't shelter them. All right, the last word for this episode is bonded. B-O-N-D-E-D, adjective from 1945, composed of two or more layers of the same or different fabrics held together by an adhesive, as in bonded jersey. So we had bonanza, Bonapartism, bonbon, bond, 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 bondage, and bonded. Well, I think I'm just going to pick bonbon as the word of the episode because, you know, let's have some bonbons and watch TV. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. It is my podcast where I read the dictionary. Yes, it is happening. We are at the top of page 141. I have a little, I have a guest with me. Her name is Audrey. She's a cat. She cannot read, but maybe she'll make some noises. Actually, she's pretty quiet. She very, very rarely makes noises. I think she's just going to curl up on the bed and take a nap, which is what I would love to do, but I have work to do. And one of those things of work is reading this book out loud to you. So the first word is bondholder. One word, noun from 1823. One that holds a government or corporation bond. Next is bonding. Noun from 1969. One, the formation of a close relationship, as between a mother and child, or between a person and an animal. Oh, this is very appropriate. Audrey, you and I have a bond. I don't think you're aware of it, but we have a bond. We are bonding. You are over there curling up to take a nap. I am sitting here reading. You are listening to me read. You don't understand what I'm saying, pretty sure, but we are currently bonding. Okay. Oh, and then the rest of that definition says, especially through frequent or constant association. Yes, especially because I'm quarantined because of this pandemic, we have frequent and constant association. You are very happy. I think our other cat is happier because she needs attention much more. All right, number 2, the attaching of a material, as porcelain, to a tooth surface, especially for cosmetic purposes. Next is bond made. That's M-A-I-D. One word, noun from 1526. It is archaic, and it is a female bond servant. I think, yes, in the last episode, at the very end, we had the word bond, which was archaic. So I guess that would be the male version, and then this one is the female version. I don't think I need to give you my personal feelings about slavery and servants, because, you know, it's not good. It's just not good. You know, I guess there are people who get paid to help out around the house, but, you know, at least I hope that they're getting paid well to do that sort of work, because they deserve it, don't you think? Okay, next is bond man. Could also be bondsman. One word, noun from the 13th century. Here we go again. The synonyms are slave and serf. Next is bond paper. Two words, noun from 1869. A durable paper originally used for documents. Next is bond servant. Noun from the 15th century. I think we can tell where this is going. One bound to service without wages. See, that's a problem. Also, the synonym slave. Next is bondsman. Similar, maybe, to what we just read. This is the first form, noun from 1713. One who assumes the responsibility of a bond. And then the synonym is, I think this is that same word that I came across before, surety. S-U-R-E-T-Y. Now we have the second form of bondsman. It is a variation of bondman, which we read before, or just maybe it's bondman? I don't know. Moving on to bondstone, one word, noun from 1823. A stone long enough to extend through the full thickness of a wall to bind it together. Okay. Yeah, you need some sort of a base for things like that, I guess. Okay. Next is bondwoman, also bondswoman. This is a noun from the 14th century, and it is, again, a female slave. What's worse, bondwoman or bondmaid? I mean, I guess there's also, and just bondman? Okay. Now we have the word bone, B-O-N-E. These are the things that keep your body from flopping around. It is the first form noun from before the 12th century. 1A, one of the hard parts of the skeleton of a vertebrate. 1B, any of various hard animal substances or structures, as baleen or ivory, akin to or resembling bone. 1C, the hard, largely calcareous, is that how you say it? Calcareous? Connective tissue of which the adult skeleton of most vertebrates is chiefly composed. 2A, synonyms are essence and core, C-O-R-E, as in cut costs to the bone, also as in a liberal to the bone. 2B, the most deeply ingrained part, synonym is heart, like the beating heart in your chest, and that is usually used in plural, as in knew in his bones that it was wrong. Number 3 is plural, and we have a number of these definitions. So first is 3A1. The synonym is skeleton. Next is 3A2. Synonym is body, as in rested my weary bones. 3A3. Synonym is corpse, as in inter a person's bones. 3B. The basic design of framework as of a play or novel. It's the bones of the thing. Number 4, synonyms are matter and subject, as in a bone of contention. 5A is plural, thin bars of bone, ivory, or wood held in pairs between the fingers and used to produce musical rhythms. So would those just be like drumsticks? Now we have 5B, a strip of material, as whalebone or steel, used to stiffen a garment, as a corset. Next is 5C. It is plural. Synonyms are, or the one synonym is dice. Next is number 6, something that is designed to placate. Synonym is sop, S-O-P, like you sop up the water that you spilled on the floor. Number 7, a light beige. Number 8, we have the 1B definition for the word inclination, as in, hadn't a political bone in his body, and that is from John Hersey. Number 9, it is slang, and we have the synonym dollar. So, bone, dollar, yeah. Boned, B-O-N-E-D, is an adjective. Boneless is something you do not want to be. It is an adjective. Bone to pick is a phrase, which means a matter to argue or complain about. All right, next is the second form of bone. It is a verb from the 15th century. First is transitive. To remove, number 1, to remove the bones from, as in bone a fish. Number 2, to provide a garment with stays. 3, to rub as a boot or baseball bat with something hard as a piece of bone in order to smooth the surface. Now we have the intransitive definition, to study hard. Synonym is grind, as in bone through medical school. I have not heard that way it's used before. All right, now we have the third form of bone. It is an adverb from circa 1825. Synonyms are extremely and very, as in bone tired. Also, the synonym totally. Next is bone ash, two words, noun from 1622. the white porous residue, chiefly of tribasic calcium phosphate from bones calcined in air, used especially in making pottery and glass and in cleaning jewelry. And our last word for this episode is bone black, two words, noun from 1815. The black residue, chiefly of tribasic calcium phosphate and carbon from bones calcined in closed vessels, used especially as a pigment or as a decolorizing absorbent in sugar manufacturing, called also bone char. Yes, I have heard of this a little bit. I didn't totally understand the definition that I just read, but I have used, like, in porcelain, yeah, they use bone char in porcelain, and I think sometimes in, like, the processing of sugar, bone char is often used, or something like that. Anyway, what is going to be the word of the episode? Bond holder. See, I was thinking about bones. Bonding, bondmaid, bondman, bondpaper, bondservant, bondsman, bondstone, bondwoman, bone ash, bone black. Well, I think I'm just going to pick bone as the word of the episode, because these things are super important to, letting us live physically, because if you had no bones, you'd have some problems. There are people, obviously, who have, you know, issues with their bones or whatever, and, you know, that really sucks. At the time of recording, we just passed the 30-year anniversary of the American Disabilities Act, which was huge, and, you know, so, and I just listened to a podcast this morning about that, and so that's on the brain, and that was just making me think of people who have physical disabilities of some kind. They have a harder time dealing with things in life, typically. Not that they're incapable of doing things, but, you know, it just, they have to do things a little bit differently. So that was my train of thought. I don't know if that made any sense, but I'm going to end this episode. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this episode of The Dictionary. I think this one should be a little bit more interesting than the last one. The last one talked a lot about slaves and bones. So we're going to try and mix it up a little bit. Here we go. The first word is bone chilling. Two words with a hyphen. Adjective from 1883. Intensely cold, as in bone chilling weather. The winters in Chicago definitely get bone chilling. I get cold to the bone, which really, really sucks. Although, with climate change, they haven't been quite as bad, I guess. But they still suck, and I don't think that climate change should be happening as bad as it is, because we are causing it. So I don't appreciate that part of it. And then it says, also, penetrating, disturbing, or intense in emotional or physical effect, as in bone-chilling drama. Also, a bone-chilling wind. Yeah, those get bad. Next is bone china, two words, noun from 1879. Translucent white china made with bone ash or calcium phosphate and characterized by whiteness. Next is bone dry with a hyphen, adjective from circa 1825. One, very dry. Number two, the number five definition for the word dry. How that's different from very dry, I don't know. We'll find out. Next is bonefish. One word, noun from 1884. One, a slender, silvery, small-scaled fish that is a notable sport and food fish of warm seas. And the scientific name is Albula vulpes. Number two, we have the number two definition for the word ladyfish. Bone fishing is a noun. Do people really say, I'm going bone fishing? I guess that would be the verb. Moving on to bonehead. It is the first form, noun from 1908. A stupid person. Synonym is numbskull. By the way, numbskull does not have a B like I would have expected it to be, have, to have. N-U-M-S-K-U-L-L. I wonder who was the first one to use bonehead way back in 1908, too. Boneheaded is an adjective, and boneheadedness is a noun. Next is the second form of bonehead, adjective from 1911. One, of relating to or characteristic of a bonehead, performed in a stupid or clumsy manner, as in, the shortstop made a bonehead play. Two, being a college course for students lacking fundamental skills, as in, teaches bonehead English. I hope that is not in the actual title of the class. Next is bone marrow, two words, noun from 1893, a soft, highly vascular modified connective tissue that occupies the cavities of most bones and occurs in two forms. A, one that is yellowish, consists chiefly of fat cells, and is found especially in the cavities of long bones. That would be your femur. And B, one that is reddish, is the chief site of blood cell formation and occurs in the normal adult in cancellous tissue, especially of certain flat bones, called also red marrow. Next is bone meal, one word, noun from 1850, crushed or ground bone used especially as fertilizer or feed. Next is boner, yeah, it's in here, noun from circa 1899, one that bones. So that would be like the person who is boning a chicken. They're taking out all the bones from the chicken or the fish. Not something that I do, but the person who's doing that is called a boner. Number two, a clumsy or stupid mistake. Also, the number two definition for howler. And then number three, probably the one that most of you are thinking of. It is usually vulgar, and it just says an erect penis. Yep, sometimes that is what it is called. I always thought it was really funny that in the show Growing Pains, there was actually a character whose nickname was Boner, because of that number three definition, and I just couldn't believe that they actually put that in a sitcom in the 80s. I thought that was crazy. But I also thought it was very funny. Moving on to bone set, one word, noun from 1764, any of several composite herbs, especially a perennial of Central and Eastern North America with opposite perfoliate leaves and white rayed flower heads used in folk medicine. And let's see, there was the genus name, Eupatorium, and then the scientific name for the perennial is Eupatorium perfoliatum. Perfoliatum. Next is bone setter, one word, S-E-T-T-E-R, and this is a noun from the 15th century. A person who sets broken or dislocated bones, usually without being a licensed physician. Okay. Next is bone up. Two words, verb from 1887. Sorry, I keep on having scratches, itches on my nose for some reason. Okay, let's see, bone up. It is, I think it's just intransitive, actually. One, to try to master necessary information quickly. Synonym is cram, as in, bone up for the exam. Number two, to renew one's skill or refresh one's memory, as in, boned up on the speech just before giving it. I'm curious about the etymology of this one. Next is boneyard, noun from 1851. Number one, synonym is cemetery. Two, a place where worn out or damaged objects, as cars, are collected to await disposal. Next is bonfire, one word, noun from the 15th century, a large fire built in the open air. This is from Middle English, bonfire, so there was an E that they had in there, and that is a fire of bones. Whoa, it literally comes from a fire of bones? Okay, wow, interesting. Next is the word bong, B-O-N-G. Looks like you could say it bong or bong. It is the first form, noun from 1853. The deep resonant sound, especially of a bell. Bong. Bong is also a verb. And then we have the second form of bong. It is a noun from 1971. a simple water pipe consisting of a bottle or vertical tube partially filled with a liquid, as water or liqueur, and a smaller offset tube ending in a bowl. So this is from, well, there's a word that I learned actually from reading this dictionary. It's B-H-A-N-G, bong, which is a, I think it's a drink made with cannabis. Ah, yes, I found it. It is a mildly intoxicating preparation of the leaves and flowering tops of uncultivated hemp. But there's more to it than that, I think, usually. And so I think, I wouldn't be surprised if this is actually from that word. It says it is a Thai word, which I cannot read, which is a hollow piece of wood or bamboo. So I suspect that those words are actually related, because it sure seems like they should be. Next is the word bongo, B-O-N-G-O. It is the first form, noun, from 1920. One of a pair of small connected drums of different sizes and pitches played with the hands. Bongoist is a noun. This is an American Spanish word, bongo. Now we have the second form of bongo. It is a noun from 1861. An African antelope, I haven't heard of this one, I don't think, that is chestnut red with narrow white vertical stripes and is found in forests from Sierra Leone to Kenya. The scientific name is, there's a couple of them it looks like, Tragelaphus uricirus, and then there's another one, Buocirus uriciros. Wow, okay. This is probably from the Kele word, which is a Bantu language of, it is a Kele word, K-E-L-E, and Kele is a Bantu language of Gabon. I hope I said that right. Gabon, I think. And then our last word for this episode is bonhomie, or it could be bonhomie, B-O-N-H-O-M-I-E. It is a noun from 1779. It means good-natured, easy friendliness. And bonhomous is an adjective. This is a French word, bonhomie, from bonhomme, which means good-natured man, which is from bon, which means good. We learned that a couple episodes ago when we read bonbon. When was that? A few episodes ago. Anyway, so it's from bon, which means good, and homme, H-O-M-M-E, which means man, bonhomme. And then they made it bonhomie. All right, so we had bone chilling, bone china, bone dry, bone fish, bone head, bone marrow, bone meal, boner, bone set, bone setter, bone up, boneyard, bonfire, bong, bongo, bonhomie. I think I'm going to pick bonfire as the word of the episode because, you know, when it's in the fall and you want to go sit outside, but it's maybe a little bit cold, you want to make a bonfire and you can cook some marshmallows and stuff. That is it for this episode. Thank you very much for listening. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye.